back there, the four rows up here.
Start with it for this presentation.
And generally, the copies are labeled A through E and also H. And the first one you see here is source A, obviously. This is from the fifth suite. And so it's written in scorditura. So although I didn't retune my cello, it looks like a D on the top line, but that's a C, because anything from the top line up is read one step lower. So this would sound. So that's the beginning of the Allemande, which you actually heard in the concert last night. And so then we should take note of the dates here. This is written by Anna Magdalena Bach, and she was Bach's second wife. She made this copy between 1727 and 1731. And that's they know that by the paper she used and her handwriting, and they can determine the dates in a pretty exact way, narrowing it down to those 4 years. The next source to look at is by Johann Kellner. And Kellner made this copy slightly earlier than the copy made by Anna Magdalena Bach. The 1726 to 1727 dates are given by a man who did some work with Kellner's manuscripts, Russell Stinson. And so my work is, in fact, layered on his work, in which he was able to date the works of Kellner according to his handwriting, and paper he used, that sort of thing. So this is actually the earliest copy of the suites that we have. We figure that the suites were written in 1720, the same year as the sonatas and partitas written for violin. And so you can see he wrote it, if we back up just one, you can see he wrote it not in scorditura. So the top note is indeed a C. And what he was doing was transcribing it from the scorditura version down a step. So we know that the original, or the copy he was working from, was written in scorditura. He made some mistakes, which make it quite obvious that he was struggling with transcribing it from scorditura into normal tuning. And his is the only copy which is in normal tuning. So we then turn to source C, and this is known as the Westfall manuscript, made probably in the second half of the 18th century sometime, by two professional copyists. They actually shifted over in the array of suite three from one copyist to another. And just recently they've discovered the name of one of those copyists, but basically they're fairly anonymous professional copyists. And then we have another anonymous copyist. This is the Treg manuscript, source D. And this is just giving you a little glimpse of what each of these manuscripts looks like. This one is even a little later, at the end of the 18th century, and we don't really know who wrote it. And finally, source E is our fifth source. This is the first edition that was published, so it was actually typeset. It could be run off in multiple copies. And this was about 100 years after the suites were written, 1824. It was based, apparently, on a manuscript that may have come from Germany. That's what this cellist Pierre Norblanc said. But that manuscript is not in existence anymore. And then finally, we have one more manuscript to look at, which is source H. And this is in Bach's handwriting. It's actually written in his, what's called his drafting hand. So when he was going really fast, this is the handwriting he used for his music. And I think he was really fast. But in any case, he would usually then write out a fair copy later, a clean copy. And we don't have such a thing for the lute suite. However, this is in his handwriting, and so it gives a lot of validity to the comparison with the cello suite manuscripts that we do have in existence. You can see some little red marks on this, and these are the kind of comparison symbols that I use throughout my edition so that various things can be compared. This is what my edition looks like page by page in the manuscripts edition. And you can see it's lined up source H at the top for the fifth suite, and then A, B, C, D, and E, and at the very bottom, my own version done in finale, which is modern notation. And so as I was saying, the only one in the non-scordatura pitch is B. And of course, the lute suite was not written in scordatura either. So we can compare those two with some, keeping that in mind, that the top line is usually a step higher than the other manuscripts. Now, looking at a timeline of the Bach suites, I already mentioned some dates, but this gives you a little bit of an idea of the manuscripts we do have. Now, we think he wrote the suites in 1720, and that's when he was in Köthen. This was a court where there were a lot of musicians who played string instruments. And so he was much more inclined to write chamber music, and in this case, solo for the cello. There were two cellists and gamba players in the court there, and so it's quite possible that one of them copied the suites for their own benefit, to have their own copy. You didn't have a photocopy machine back then. So Bach then moved to Leipzig, and you can see the date of when the sonatas and partitas were written in 1726. Not written, but copied by Kilner. And so we can suppose that this copy of Kilner also dates from about the same time. And as I mentioned on the work of Stinson, we can narrow that down to be about the same time. It's quite likely that Kilner did not copy from an original in Bach's handwriting. He probably copied from some other intermediate copy made by perhaps one of those cellists in the court at Köthen. And we know that that's a likely possibility because when we look at Kilner's copy of the violin sonatas and partitas, it's quite obvious what he was copying from, and it was not Bach's original. It was an intermediate copy. And in fact, Kilner didn't meet Bach until the year after that, in 1727. Now, the other copies we have in existence, A, H, D, C, and E, those are placed on the timeline so you can get some feeling of how this is laid out chronologically. But if we fill this in with, first of all, the piece is written by Bach. So at the top left, you see this is the original that we have to imagine was written in 1720, and then followed by a possible clean copy, which Bach would have written most likely, because he did this quite often for pieces that he'd written out. He would produce a second clean copy. And then, in general, we use Greek letters as a protocol for anything that's not in existence, but which we can imagine is happening. So you can see the original is labeled Omega, and then the possible clean copy, Alpha. And then you look ahead, and you can see that some things are possibly related to this intermediate copy in court of Köthen. So we call that Gamma. And adding on a couple more intermediate copies, such as the one listed by the man who discovered the manuscript in Germany and brought it to France, where the first edition was published, we can imagine some other intermediate things happening before we get to C, D, and E. So you can see that C, D, and E are, at the very best, about third-hand copies, maybe not as trustworthy as other things. And we know for sure that Bach wrote those in 1720, and then the clean copy is a supposition, and that led to the Köthen copy, perhaps, and then we have the copy by Kilner, and we don't really know for sure what he was copying from, but it appears that it was coming from some intermediate copy. So I'm just sort of recapping what we have just talked about. And you can see these arrows then show how things might have been passed down. And the most from the original version and not from the clean copy, because it happened at the same time when Bach was making his transcription for lute. And so you see H at the bottom and A coming in at the same years there. And so it's quite possible that we have little changes and things that Bach made in his clean copy that he then used in the lute suite, and which perhaps Kilner has influence from. And then these other copies, we can only suppose how they're all connected, but you can see more and more intermediate copies leading all the way down to the first edition. And so as things were passed along, things got added by editors who thought, oh, this note might be better, or they made a mistake, or they added some bowing that they liked, or whatever. And so there are a lot of those things that appear at C, D, and E. So these are the comparison symbols. Oh, I got to turn off the sound here. These are the comparison symbols, and just if you do download my edition from my website, you'll become more familiar with these. But basically, if notes are different, then I mark it with an X. If one of them is an obvious error, I put brackets around it. If there are ornaments that are different or rhythmic duration that are different, then those have other signs that are used. And to give you some idea of the way in which I edited this edition, this is what a typical page looked like from the Kilner manuscript. And you can see it's kind of a jumble to figure out which notes to look at. So, for instance, if I was going to be using these on a particular line in my edition, these were the measures I need on that line, then I cut them in Photoshop, line them up next to each other, align them so they're level, and then removed all the extra things from the often the ink on the back of the page would come through onto the front of the page, and obviously the nearby lines have other things going on. And so I did a lot of Photoshop work to make it look like that, cleaning everything up. So a lot of work with the mouse. and so the next thing I'd like to explain to you is something about the way in which we can approach looking at these different manuscripts and trying to figure out what is valid, what is probably written by Bach. And again, my work is built on the work of someone else. This is a man named James Freer, who wrote a book about how to edit music and how to critically determine what's called affiliation, or the, you can think of it as the ancestry of different documents. And the most enlightening thing is when you have a clear error in one of them. You can see if there's an original, and let's say three copies were made, and the third copy had an X error somewhere, so I would have marked it in my edition with an X. Well, that is a clue then. If it's found in a later copy, you have a copy that has that same error, and it shows that it was in some way derived from the previous copy. Other things are not so clear, but when it's an error, you can definitely trace. And so determining what is an error is a critical thing. And in addition, there's one more term to learn, and that's the word exemplar. So copy 3 becomes the exemplar, the model that was copied, and produced copy 5 with an error. So copy 3 is the exemplar of copy 5. So an understanding of the relationship between these sources is important for interpreting, knowing which notes to play. And a good place to start is suite 5, because we have the lute suite we can compare to. In the suite 5, we have various things that are marked with the red X's that you can see here in the lute suite. In particular, there are a couple of appoggiaturas that he added. There are two dots on those quarter notes in the third measure, and then a bass line that he added. So in some parts of the lute suite, he's adding additional notes because the lute could produce more harmonies to go with it. But for the most part, we can determine the comparison as we look at the cello suites. And in particular, I'd like to point out how the lute suite is arranged. It's in G minor rather than C minor, but the top line is written in tenor clef. So obviously the difference between tenor clef and bass clef is a fifth. And so if you read it as bass clef, it comes out sounding exactly like the Bach cello suites, just changing the clef with a little bit of difference in the chromatic signs. The bass line is written in bass clef. So those are those signs that are showing slight differences. And then when we compare to between source H and source A, you can see here that Ina Magdalena Bach made a mistake. She put two legend lines on that bass note. And so this is the Quran, which starts. In terms of the music, it's a rising line through the bass line, typical Bach, and so the E flat fills that in. And you can see that Kellner and the lute suite version both have E flat. So looking then as written in modern notation, you can see in my edition that it's marked that way, that the E flat appears in sources B and H, and the low C appears in sources A, C, D, and E. And those dots only appear in source C and H. So interesting overlap between the different sources. And so this is what we see, that source A has filiation, the word I was introducing you to earlier, filiation that leads to sources C, D, and E, all three of which have the low C. And this is not an unusual occurrence in these manuscripts. We see some other examples too. In the Gavotto Suite 5, we have a note here which it's marked an X there, right where the little arrow is. And you can see that it's got two legend lines instead of one. And this also got passed along to sources C, D, and E. So there's a connection between those, and on the other hand, we have a connection between the lute suite and Kellner source, which both have the correct note. It's even more of an obvious mistake, because that mistake makes this F that's printed there in the scordatura would be played as an E flat. And there's just no way that anyone would want to play an E flat followed by the next note after it. So it just, since I'm not tuned to scordatura, I don't think I will try to play that one for you, but it would sound really bad with the E flat, believe me. And so there are various other examples like this. Here's a rhythmic example in which the rhythm is reversed, actually, in source A compared to source B and H, which have source A, we see the rhythm of an eighth and 2/16ths, which get past sources C, D, and E. So this is all very interesting to see that the same sort of mistake in filiation is happening over and over as we look at suite 5. And there's an example now here from, this one example showing that indeed Bach was writing from a scordatura version. And at the top there you can see where the arrow is pointing, he made a little mistake. Pretty uncommon to think that Bach made any mistakes, but he actually wrote a couple notes in scordatura by accident. And so it shows that he was transcribing it from the cello version. And I think that's important to understand because it shows the chronology that the cello version came before the lute suite. And Kilner also struggled to transpose that spot. You can see a lot of red marks all around the Kilner version also. Here's another example taken from the prelude of the fifth suite. And this is one that a lot of people don't play in what I would consider to be the correct pitch. It has a that most people play, but the A on the bottom, where the arrow is marked, is indeed what we find in the lute suite and in Kilner suite, in Kilner manuscript. So where those two arrows are pointing, you see an A natural. And looking at the copy made by Hanneke Lynne Bach, you can see that there's a G every other measure for the two measures and four measures before that. And so what people have done is continued that same bass note, or it certainly is what Hanneke Lynne Bach did. It actually appears as though she, her note head is on a G, but it's rather large, as though she kind of had to go over it a couple times with a pen. I'm not sure what that means, but the A natural is very clear in the other two parts. And when there's something that is continued from a previous pattern, like this G, two bars and four bars before, and then repeated by accident, this is called a mistake of perseveration. One more term for you today for your vocabulary. So perseveration, a mistake of perseveration means something that has been copied from a previous sort of series of something, but incorrectly. And so you can see again the connection here. But the interesting thing to find also is that source E, the first edition, has the A natural in it. So this is indeed puzzling. How did source E get the A natural? So just to give you some idea of the sounds, we have, let's see. So replicated in C and D, but again, we find a correction in E. So I would say you can pretty much count on the fact that C and D have some things that didn't get traced back to what Bach wrote, and often traces to a mistake that Annemiek Johanna Bach made in her manuscript. You know, there are some performers, like Anna Bielsma, who said he would play everything exactly as in the Annemiek Johanna Bach manuscript. And he felt that she was a fine musician and had copied everything correctly. Well, I don't think he plays this F sharp, or a few of these other spots. So we can compare all these different sorts of things as we look at the suites. Slurs, pitches, trills, rhythm, quadratures, chords. Really, all of these things have some mistakes that we can find or that we can determine have been added by intermediate copyists. And so let's just go through and take maybe a couple examples from each suite, because I'm sure some of you are working on one suite or another, and this might give you a new note to play, perhaps, or a different slur, or a different rhythm. This is just opening of the first suite. You can see the two pages lined up next to each other, or two lines next to each other, so you can see the pattern of the bowings. And I'd just like to point out here that the bowing pattern, as you look carefully at it, always has slurs on first and third beat, but never on the second and fourth beat. And so that's something to keep in mind. You look down, though, at, say, source D, and you can see a slur on almost every beat in some cases, like in the third measure. Very inconsistent in some of the other spots. But it gives you some idea of the overall pattern, and I would say you want to look especially at sources A and B. And then let's say, this is the most famous example of all, perhaps, is this spot in the fringe of the first suite, where we have this pattern. First of all, it comes up. I've got to figure out where I'm starting. Going to a C sharp on the. And then this fourth note of that beat, of the third beat, which is in different editions, sometimes a B natural or a B flat. And you can see the line connecting that through the different sources. The B flat originates solely in the source E, the first edition. So some editor along the way, or a cellist who wanted to play it that way, marked it that way with a B flat, with an augmented second. But sources A, B, C, and D all have B natural. And the important thing to consider here is how chromatic signs were marked differently in the Baroque period compared to the modern period. At that time, it was considered important to remark the chromatic sign in the measure throughout the measure, unless it was incredibly obvious. But you can see that the B natural is not marked. That's because it's in key signature. And then the B flat is marked on that fourth 16th note. And so this means that you really should be playing a B natural on the first one. So this is a practice that was quite common in the Baroque period, but as you look at the copies of the Bach suites, you'd find various cases where it's quite inconsistent. So I don't think it's something you can count on. However, this is a flat mark after the B that we're talking about. And so the first one, without any marking, would be considered natural. And let's see, I marked these little arrows just to show you exactly the spot. The chromatic signs aren't reiterated if it's quite obvious that they're implied. So you can see this, you have the C sharp, the B flat, but then the next note is also B flat, and they don't mark another flat on that one. None of the copyists did that. Just it's two notes in a row, and you're not going to play. That would just be weird. So somebody got in there and did their own editing, I think, and said, let's do it this way. I think this is better than what Bach wrote. And so, let's see. We've talked about that already. And so it's just source E that made this rather dreadful mistake for the B flat being marked on that second 16th. And then there's that augmented second, which is in all three of those sources. Looking at measure 26 just one more time, you can see how it worked in my addition with all the little X's and brackets. And that's just showing where these incorrect notes are. So it's easy to spot in the addition. And so I would say this demonstrates that whenever sources A and B are in agreement about something, probably that's a very trustworthy thing, and you can rely on those being the correct notes. Here's an example from the second suite in the Alemann. I was just talking about this yesterday in a master class over at University of Nevada, Las Vegas. The only place that we find this tritone between an A and a D sharp is in the Kilner copy. This is in the Alemann of the second suite. So this is this F, which leads to another third. So it makes sense to be playing the harmony instead of just the A in this spot. And one more spot in the Carano suite too. We have this up. And in some editions you find So that's just showing you at the exact spot of those lines, marking it through, and going up to the F. And in more detail, a little bigger, so you can see just between sources A and B. In the Sarabanda Suite 3, this is just an example of appoggiaturas that got added. And so you can see, this is something I don't think anybody plays, to go. And then. But along the way, somebody put these in sources C, D, and E. And so they're marked in my edition, but as you can see in the bottom line there, C, D, and E are indicated as the sources, so you can probably discount anything that's marked that way. Every now and then there's something like a trill that you may like that's in C, D, and E, or an appoggiatura, and then I would say, sure, go ahead and add it. I mean, they did ornaments in the Baroque period, and as you go on in the 18th century, appoggiaturas became more and more popular, which I think is a good indicator of why they are added in these later copies. Cellists want to play them. And sometimes they're added in a place where it simply leads to a trill and indicates that you would start the trill on the top note, which of course was the general approach to trill in the Baroque period. So I would say the appoggiaturas that you see marked with C, D, and E are generally stylistically appropriate, but perhaps not written by Bach. In the Prelude of Suite 4, there's this rather striking example here that came also out of a mistake in source E in the first edition. So we have this series of 16th notes in this passage, and the pitch B flat is in A, B, C, and D, but a B double flat is marked in source E, and it's really amazing how many people play that. I would say 90% of the performances have that B double flat, which is something that got added in the first edition. Let me see if I can. It's a hard place to start. Let's see. So we have. So I'm starting in the second bar there, or the third bar. And a B double flat sounds. But that's what I think is the appropriate note in this spot. And here's another one in Suite 4 in Courant. This spot where we're going. And I always play this B flat. But it only appears in source B, C, and D. No, it actually is an E as well. This is, again, just a mistake in source A. But as I was saying, some people stick to whatever they find in source A, and this is a good case of something that's different from all the other sources in source A, and so probably a mistake. But either note works in the style, so I'm not sure you can say definitively that it's a mistake, unless you compare to those other copies and then think about the filiation that we've talked about and determine that way that most likely it should be a D flat. So you can see the D flat in all of those copies. Now in the Prelude of Suite 6, there's another sort of interesting spot here where we're going on. And then what you see here on the screen. And some editions have just on the last beat instead of. So imitates the previous bar, the one I started with. I thought I put that in there, but I guess not. So we have the perseveration from the previous bar, and you can see the connection here going down to source of C, D, and E, copied from source A. So in this case, I think because of the logic of the previous bar, it makes sense to do the same thing as we find at source B. And one more example then from suite 6 in Gavotte 1, we have a note that often gets left out. It's the bass note G in this particular spot. And I'm not sure why it got left out, but I got my slides in the wrong order here, sorry. That's showing the previous example. And so you can, just to back up to the previous example, you can see both lines here, the previous measure being, and then where the three arrows are, it goes downward. And so this next one, it makes sense to go down on the last beat the same way. And so I think we won't back up and look at that other example from the jig, from the Gavotte of suite 6. But one more little example from the jig of suite 6. We have this very interesting spot that goes and a lot of people just play instead of. Again, this is something found only in source B, but if you think about the very beginning of the jig, we have. So it's a little motive of the theme, which then gets reused here, and I think it's quite possible that Bach made a revision in this spot, and then Kellner's copy reflects that revision. So I think that is a pretty complete presentation about my research, and I'd just like to show you what my edition looks like. Let's see, I gotta figure out how to do this. Maybe Andy. Yeah, go to the edition. Oh, there we go. So this is what the title page of the edition looks like. It's 619 pages in a huge PDF, and all of these underlined things are clickable links, so they're hyperlinks. You can go to any of these things, editorial notes or navigating interpretation, but say if you're going to look at suite 3, you would click on that, and then you get a subdirectory where you can see manuscripts and scores. You can go to a particular part like Courant, let's say, and you see the Courant written out in normal notation. But if you then click on either the title of the movement or the page number, it will put you into the score version, the manuscript version. And you can then compare these different sources. And you can page through that a line at a time by clicking, well, that's not working on the laptop here. Maybe just the arrow. Yeah, with the arrow key, you can then move through it. It works really great on an iPad. You can just touch the side of the screen and move through it page at a time, or use your foot pedal and page through it while you're playing. And then you can be examining the manuscripts and just move through them like this, one line at a time. And so I hope you're all intrigued by that and have perhaps some questions.
Yeah, any questions? Yeah. 2 minutes.
When Starker put together the Bach suites, did he use a particular manuscript, or did he do his own research?
I don't know very much about that, except that I do know that in some cases he changed harmonies just actually following a lot of the first edition, the source E. So there are some rather dissonant chords, for instance, in the sixth suite with sevenths and things, and he used some rewrites of those that appear in source E. Thank you. Yes?
We found that any order editorial notes or extra discoveries are at odds in any way from other texts like Wire, for example.
Yes, there are differences. I think mine is a little more comprehensive. I think I've found just about everything worth comparing and marked it with these little symbols. And I think it's easier to navigate through mine as well. The Baron Rider also costs about 5 times as much. back to your question, I would say there are two kinds of editions. There's a performer's edition, and there's a scholarly, often called per-text edition. And the Starkweather edition is definitely a performer's edition. And those are useful sometimes. You get good fingerings out of them. One thing I really like about the approach using a PDF and the iPad, if you've used an iPad, I hope you have an Apple Pencil as well, so you can write on it with a pencil. And you can change the color to white, and you can white out anything you don't like. You can change it back to black and put in your own slurs. You can add your own chromatic signs if you wanted to play different notes. All that is possible using the PDF.
If they want to buy your edition, how do they do that?
Just go to my website, which is starkweatherdavid.com.
And I think you didn't talk about it, but you do have a DVD set, like I mentioned, that you play while the manuscripts are also on.
That's true.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody's looking at DVDs anymore, or CDs for that matter.
But in case they are.
Yeah, I did that in 2005. And I have to say I've changed a few notes based on my research since 2005 in terms of which notes I would play.
Hang on, one hand over there. Could you raise your hand? Well, maybe it's... but I do have a question. So, like, say if you have... So that was so fascinating to hear, like, there are certain notes that, yeah, comparative editions, this one is, you know, more correct. Do you have cases that you're like, both of them actually sounds pretty good. Like, I got, like, one of them, the D and B flat there. How do you feel like how to decide which one you would, you know, ultimately choose? Or, like, you know, especially bowing is particularly hard.
Uh-huh. Well, I don't know how to go back and forth in this edition.
Yeah.
Your laptop. I'm a Mac person, but let's see, how would I do that? Oh, we're in the third suite, so I can find this one pretty easily.
It's not that suite.
Yeah, we just go forward to the second array of the third suite. And in this particular case, this is one that actually is used by Greer in his book, which talks about the critical editing of music. And he says this is a case where either possibility is stylistically correct. And so you can't really make up your mind based on the style. So we have... and right here, I have now chosen to play A flat. Something like that. just because in A and B you don't see nearly as many slurs marked. I would say that has perhaps more of an influence on how someone might approach the character of a movement or bringing out the dance-like quality. And so, you know, whether you play a flat or a natural, little note changes like that, I found it meaningful in terms of deciding what I wanted to play. But when you hear a performance, I don't think that's the main thing you're influenced by in terms of whether it's a satisfying performance. And I've heard people who played very nicely in the Bach suites, but played all the sources differently from what I would choose, and it still is, you know, a good performance. But I would encourage you to make your own choices, and that's why I got started originally on making this edition. So I wanted it for my own use, and then it grew and grew and became something that is actually useful for everybody.
Wonderful. Any more questions? Okay, one more. This will be the last one.
Okay. do you ever use like other works like the Sonatas and Partitas to help figure out, like when you were talking about the tritone, that issue, that seems to appear fairly often in some of the Sonatas and Partitas, right? Where it might not be as much here. Do you ever kind of go back and forth and maybe like, if there's a question, let that kind of influence since it was written at the same time?
Not so much in terms of tritones or particular harmonies, but certainly with some bowings and things, I think that's really relevant. And if you go to my website, you'll find several videos where I do short lectures talking about different aspects of this. In one of them, I'm comparing the Kellner copy of the Sonatas and Partitas and the Hanna Magdalena Bach copy of the Sonatas and Partitas. And there we have Bach's original, and so you can compare between what she wrote and what Bach wrote, and she pretty much ignored a lot of those bowings. I mean, she was a trained singer. She really probably didn't care about bowings. Or even, in any case, for copying, I think they were usually in a big hurry, and they were using a pen and ink, and they made a lot of mistakes. But it's an interesting